Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to... Oh, passing the heinies. Sorry, I just caught up. I'm not going to look that way. This is the thing. Last episode, I was sat here on this side and I was looking at the crowd and it was like distracting me so much. So I'm glad that
you're
going to
sit
here
this way. So I get and distracted now.
Exactly.
Yeah. Oh, that's all right.
welcome back to Chatting Breeze, episode 8? Yeah, 8, I think. This week, got none other than Borai in the stew, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes, yes.
Everyone at home, everyone in the crowd, round of applause. There we go. Lovely stuff. Obviously...
Whoop, whoop.
Exactly. Obviously, you all know Borai. If you don't know Borai...
to know.
There's literally no point in even bothering trying to explain. You've heard all his tunes. You've definitely heard... one of his recent ones that we'll probably get into at some point in this episode. Part of Club Glow, now recently formed a new label, Offbeat, one we'll also be getting into. How's it going, Boris, my man?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm very good. Thank you.
Apologies for the technical difficulties before
we started up. That's just life.
Mate, we're underground out here. You know, we're not. This isn't exactly Radio 1, but we're trying our best.
Oh, mate, is it not? I didn't realise.
Oh, yeah. What gave it away? Was it the man sipping wine behind the by the recording booth, or?
I always thought that Radio 1 was very relaxed. So maybe. I mean, who knows?
I think so. Have you had much experience with Radio 1?
No.
Well, there you go then.
Not directly.
Elaborate. Question mark?
Oh, well, I've been played on Radio 1, that's why.
Okay, but I haven't been there.
I haven't been broadcast or anything like that.
You got Track of the Week, though, right?
Yeah, it was, yeah, Greg James.
Yeah, that's something. Yeah. That's probably what... Oh, sorry. It's as is customary on Chatting Breeze, I have to open my beer on my phone.
Right, yeah. Very nice.
Thank you. Oh, you got to reverb that.
Yeah, right. I noticed... That's the snare in my next tune.
Yes. In the last episode, there were a couple that weren't reverbed, Ryan. I'm not going to lie to you. So, yeah, you got Greg James' Track of the Week with Make Me, which was you and Denham, right?
Yeah, me and Denham already.
How did that happen? Do you have to submit your stuff for that?
No.
He
just picks it. It's interesting going through the whole thing that I've gone through with Make Me, but essentially it being signed to a major label.
Mm.
It's been really interesting to see that side of the world, because the last 20 years I've been doing underground stuff, nowhere near major labels or anything like that. Or if anything, it's been like larger independents or people, you know. And then suddenly I'm now dealing with Columbia. Oh shit. And who else is on it? Oh, Mariah Carey and Depeche Mode.
No, fuck, those are two quite contrasting names.
And yeah, right.
You add Borai and Denham Audio as well. Unreal.
So there's a lot of stuff that happens that goes on behind the scenes. And there's a lot of stuff within management, and there's a lot of stuff within the marketing that is about that. It's all about kind of like sending stuff just in case. So one of the examples is, so for the Greg James thing, we clocked that he'd kind of got on it. You know, these radio DJs, they are kind of switched on. If there's a tune that's on the up and they're hot and it's hot, either the management or the company might send it to them and say, hey, have you heard this one? Because they like to, you know, trumpet their own shows.
Yeah.
So if they can get a track that then gets big, they love that because brilliant. So if they can see that something's a bit popular and no one else is kind of championing it, then maybe you might be able to get it under their nose and they go, ooh, this is nice. And what happened was that he played it and talked about it and then sung the little bit. He did he kind of sung.
This is it as well.
Lyrics. What I then did was like the management or the marketing and the record label spotted that happened. So it's like, okay, well, why don't we do a remix and just replace the vocal with his vocal?
Is that what I saw? Because I saw an Instagram reel somewhere that had like a weird vocal on it. I wasn't sure what it was.
Yeah, that was Greg James. So it was Greg James. So he sung it. He was like, he was talking about it and then he sung it. And it was before he made it Tune of the Week. And so we then capitalized on that and on their kind of ego. So it's like, remix it. And so it was just going to be like a 10-second thing, but I just did the whole tune.
Mad.
And then sent it back to them. And then that was it. He loved it. He played it. He then made it Tune of the Week.
So. That's the Greg James remix. Is it out anywhere?
No, it's not. It's surely a dub.
Yeah. Have you ever played that one out?
No. That was purely for just that little moment. And it was quite fun. Yeah. You can, you know, but there's a lot of kind of like... things get organised in the background. It's management and people and labels and marketing are all kind of emailing others and saying, oh, hey, would you... And same with things like mixes and, you know, features as part of that. They very much kind of hit you up beforehand and say, oh, hey,
yeah,
do you want to do this? And a lot of that comes out of the management, maybe talking to them, or if you've got someone on the ground who represents you. This is what I find with the major labels. It's like you really need management.
You need like a middleman.
You need a middleman or a middle person, because the labels don't want to talk to you. They want to talk to your representative.
Why?
Because they want to talk about money and talk about things that you're going to get annoyed about or not understand or don't get because you're an artist. You need someone to
discuss. You're just a stupid little artist.
Well, not quite, but in terms of like, it can make things go a hell of a lot easier when you've got someone, talk about money, for example, means you don't have to talk about it. They talk about it. Mm-hmm. And they're interested in chatting to someone where they can talk about you.
Yeah,
right?
I guess that's the
rather
thing,
than talking in the third person or as a third, as a third party. And the other thing you realise is that certainly with the major labels in the UK, they're all based in London.
Mm-hmm.
They all know each other. Mm-hmm. All the A&R guys and all the management for all of, all the managers for all the artists, they all know each other. They all go to the same parties. They all go to the same pubs. They all hang out. They're literally friends. And when you get in meetings with them, oh, hello, mate. How are you? No way. And it's like, fucking hell, it's just a back slappy boys club, right?
It sounds horrible.
Yeah. And it's also what you come across is you suddenly come across people who are working within these record labels who could quite easily be accountants, but they just decided they were going to get a job in the music industry instead because, decent money. But they don't really have this, like, they don't understand music.
Yeah.
And the higher up you go, they just understand less.
This is it, isn't it? It's like, like a lot of that. Yeah, for the large label, people don't get into it for the music.
No, they get into it for the regular wage and the prestige of working within the music industry. Mm. But when you talk to them, they reveal themselves really quickly by what they say and how they say it and what they understand. They just don't, in terms of like underground music, they haven't got a clue.
Yeah.
They know nothing. They know literally what their A&R guys have told them.
Hmm.
And the A&R guys are the ones that are like on the ground going to the parties. And even they don't know everything.
Yeah.
Because most of the good underground stuff doesn't either... They're not prepared to look outside of London or go anywhere. Mm. There's not a single A&R person in Bristol, right, for a major label. They're all in London because they will get, part of being an A&R is you can go to loads of stuff and get stuff for free and be in there in the middle of it all. So it really, things genuinely go a bit quicker and start to happen when you're there.
Mm.
And so to have management who's there, if you're not there, then that's very helpful. And that's something I kind of was quite thankful for, is that we managed to get management representation for the deal.
Mm-hmm.
So I wasn't going into this big deal with them talking to us and discussing stuff without actually having someone who had already been through it before, who came highly recommended and ended up doing a really good job. And, I didn't sign with them as a manager. They're not my manager now, but they came on as a one deal.
Oh, that's so handy.
Which is really handy. That came from Denham Audio.
Okay.
And that was his guys. He's now signed with them as a manager.
Okay, nice.
Yeah. And they look after... They kind of came to success through two young guys called Prosper.
Mm-hmm.
And it's them who were the management behind them. So they got massive. So they've already gone through this whole thing before and they know a lot of people. Right. So Denham was chatting to them about possibly signing with them.
Mm-hmm.
And then when the whole Make Me thing started to happen, he kind of said, look, do you want me to talk to the guys and see if they'll come on and do it as like a one deal thing? And they were totally up for it. And I was up for it because it meant that there was someone that, who kind of knew what they were talking
about.
Yeah,
this is it.
And we could ask questions for. And also they can ask the questions that you don't necessarily want to ask.
Yes.
They can be cheeky
as hell.
That's
the thing.
Like, I'm turning up to these meetings being like, oh, I'm going to be very good, blah, 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 and he's coming in calling everyone a cunt.
Yeah.
Are you fucking... It's like, whoa, okay, right. Oh, this is a whole different vibe, right?
You need someone that backs you like that.
Yeah. That's the thing I realised, and that was it. Because essentially what happened with Make Me was that we got into... a bidding war.
Yes.
That's basically what happened. Like, the major labels got wind of it, they got sniff of it, and suddenly they all started going, oh, we need to get on this because this is going to be the next thing. And then, of course, because they all know each other, they all talk to each other. And so then they all start going, so it was just one Tuesday afternoon, I was at work, and then suddenly I just got like, ping, 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 ping. Hi, I'm from Columbia. Hi, I'm from Ministry of Sound.
Oh, my God.
Like, hi, I'm from Sony. Hi, I'm from Universal. Hi, I'm from, like, whoa, what's going on? But why?
Yes.
The tune has been out for 5 years.
This is what I was going to say. I had this tune years and years
yes,
ago.
Yes, yes, yes. Like, I mean, there's been a whole story with it.
Where did it release on initially?
Originally, when it came out, I think it was 2015 or something like that. We put it out as part of Club Glow number one. Club Glow Volume 1.
Yeah, that was... Yeah.
And we put it out ourselves. We put it on cassette. It then went on Bandcamp and it did really well. It got really successful. Some DJ Seinfeld and Peach picked it up and started playing it everywhere. It did so well that I ended up putting out... I pressed it up. Mm. I did 700 plus copies of it on vinyl, which is like, wow.
Yeah.
My distributors love me.
Yeah, I'm sure.
And so that's kind of sold out and did really well. And then... I think it's a year or two after we had put it out originally. Hang on.
I've got a horrible cough today as well, so just don't allow it. Yeah.
And Club Glow then decided, we as Club Glow wanted to put our back catalogue up onto Spotify. Mm. So we included Make Me as that because it was in volume number, you know.
For sure.
Number one. So we put it up, not really thinking about it. And it just kind of started to go silly because it started to get put in playlists and people started playing it and the tunes. And it got to 1 million plays. And we were like, whoa.
Wow.
And it was, you know, it was 7 or 8 months. I mean, it was a few years to do that in terms of its combination. But once we put it on Spotify, it then started to kick. And then it hit 1 million plays and we got a cease and desist from the publishers of this sample that we'd
What is the original sample again?
Donna Allen's Serious.
Right, okay. And it's
so
quite,
an 80s, quite a lot, it's an 80s R&B tune. Mm-hmm. So it's like 1985 or something. Mm-hmm. And it's a sample, but... It was also sampled in the early 90s by Strike, when they did their track You Sure Do, that got into the charts.
Yeah, so that's what I know it from.
Yeah, lots of people do. And also, I was trying to work out why is it that Make Me came, why is it so popular, right? Why, how, what?
Yeah.
And I think part of it was that it hit quite a few... Because it hit all the people that know, it hit the people that know Strike.
Yeah.
It hit the people that know the original Donna Allen, because that's been sampled a few times, but also it's like the R&B fans that love that. And
for
then
sure.
But then it also hit all the new people who hadn't heard either of them.
Yeah.
And they enjoyed
Big
it.
Big Andrew one as well.
She did, I mean, that was much later.
Yeah.
That was in once it had been signed, then they got into the whole let's do some remixes.
Oh, really? Okay.
So originally it was just on its own. There were no remixes of it. It was just a single. I was about to do a remix 12 inch that had 4 remixes on it. A Breaker one, an L Major one, an AK Sports one.
Wow, yeah.
And hang on. Breaker, L Major, AK Sports. Oh, yeah, Manifesto.
Okay,
so there were 4, and I was going to put it on vinyl, and then we got the cease and desist, so I had to pull that.
More guests.
Oh, interrupts.
Hey!
Yes, yes.
What's going on? Hello.
Welcome.
Sit down. Move. What is that box doing there? My goodness me.
Okay. Yeah.
Take a seat, Alice. Oh, yeah, take off your shoes, of course. Get your stinky feet out. Oh, sorry. No. Stay.
Careful.
Oh. Yeah, so you were going to do the remix 12-inch.
So I was going to do the remix 12-inch. It was in press. It was. I was literally in press, and then we got the cease and desist, and they were like, yeah, we have to cancel it and have to pull it. And you now owe us the money for that.
Oh.
And luckily for me, they hadn't pressed it. They had it mastered, and then they'd made the plates, the stampers.
Yeah.
And then they got the cease and desist. So I persuaded them to send me back. I've got the stampers. I was like, look, I have to pay
them.
All this. Yeah, yeah. I was like, I'm paying all this money. It was like £600 or £700 I had to pay for the mastering costs and the TP. And I don't think they even pressed any TPs. So I didn't get any TPs. They were just about to press the TPs, the test presses. And there would have been at least like 5 copies ever. But it didn't make it that far. But I have the stampers.
So the stampers.
So at some point,
the stampers is like what? Like it's just a stamp, or it's like a record that's not been etched, or what is
yeah,
it?
Yeah, no. So a stamper is in the vinyl mastering process, you master your record, and the way it gets mastered, it gets cut onto an acetate. That acetate is the master. That then gets sent to the pressing plant. They then make the stampers from the master, and that's essentially electroplating. You have two, A side and a B side, and they get electroplated and coated in like nickel or whatever it is. Mm. And then what you're left with is like this metal positive. So instead of having grooves, it's got ridges. And so that's what you have either side of the pressing plant. And that's what goes into the pressing plant. And actually, I think there's another process in there where you do one and then you take another and then you do another. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, what
is it playable?
No, because it's a reverse.
Right.
Because, of course, it's you can't play it. What you do is you put it in a machine, you make 5 or 6.
Right, I see.
That's the test press.
So
I could, if I wanted to, and the record plant would let me, which is a lot of them don't, because, of course, this was already caught up in a cease and desist, so maybe no one wants to touch it.
Uh-huh.
But if I was clever, I could send these to the pressing plant. They could put them straight in the machines and start pressing records.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like I've already saved myself that first process. But for me, it was just having it. I've just paid all this fucking money. Give it to me.
Yeah.
I own that.
Yeah.
right? But so it's mine. So they did. They saw sense and they sent it to me, and I got a box. And I've opened it, looked at it, and closed it, and put it away.
Nice, classic.
And, yeah. And maybe one day I'll mount them or frame them or whatever. But yeah,
you have had a bunch of remixes on that now that have come out. Now that you've sort of got all the shitty legal stuff dealt with.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. I mean, once we got signed, and so we'd gone through the signing process, essentially they start the bidding process. Those labels that are genuinely interested, then it starts to galvanise to like two or three or three or four, and then it gets down less, and then they start giving their offers of what they're going to offer for that. Mm. And then you start kind of returning and saying, well, no, not really. Mm-hmm. Don't want that. Or maybe like, you know, all these stupid games that you play. But after you've done that, we decided to go with the label that eventually released
right.
it.
Right, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Partly because they impressed us with the fact of, you know, how professional they were and their plan for it. And then there was this great moment where, because the way that it works is Sony own Columbia, and Columbia then own this other record label called Room 2.
Right.
Which is essentially what they call a joint venture. Uh-huh. So there's a guy that runs Room 2.
Yeah.
And he basically decides what goes on the label, but all the money comes from Columbia.
It's all so messy, isn't it?
So, yeah, it's very messy, but it's to appear as if there's all these labels, but essentially it's one giant pyramid that goes back up to Sony, right? Uh-huh. That's ultimately it.
But this is actually a subdivision of Universal.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You're a Universal JV.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a JV, nice. and that means you can get a budget for signing artists and doing and marketing and this kind of stuff. Whereas because he was with Columbia and he was a JV, he was essentially an in-house record label at Columbia.
Right.
So he worked in the Columbia built in the Sony building
right.
in the Columbia office, and they have a little office based in there, but whenever they do marketing, they're not paying to go third party people, they're just using Columbia's marketing team. So in the first meeting he was like, oh yeah, well this is the guy that will be doing this, is Henry, he'll be doing the marketing. Yeah, this he did Calvin Harris's Martin. Oh, okay, cool. Right, it's like, oh yeah, all right, yeah, wicked.
But this,
right,
this is what I really rate about like you and all the things that you do is that you've had this experience, you've done this, you've had this crazy thing with Make Me, that you're still sat in Orion's bedroom doing the Developers podcast.
Yes, absolutely. I think I was very conscious of that going in. Uh-huh. One of the things I wanted was like, okay, the majors are here to play, but I know that, but I'm not looking to go major, right? I'm not looking to, oh, wow, this is the thing I've been after. I want to get signed to a major label and then we're going to go down that whole route. I want to be the next whoever, right? Mm. Part of it was just like, well, look, they're interested. So what do they have? They have marketing so they can get Make Me, you know, they want it, let it go. So the deal that we did was just for Make Me. Mm-hmm. We were offered, you know, what they call options. So they'll sign the track and then they'll say, well, you know, we want two, three or four options, which is basically three or four more tunes.
Right.
Every 6 months you work towards having another record that they can then put out. Because you know, most of the time they don't, it's like they're hedging their bets. They don't know if the first one's going to go bam, and if it doesn't, maybe the second one is. And the example that was put to us was LF Systems. So everyone's talking about, oh, you're going to be the next LF Systems. Ooh. And then we found out that it was their second track. It was their option track that got massive, which is why we're hearing about them now, why they're playing in all the stupid festivals and all of this kind of stuff. Mm. Their first track didn't do very well, but they then learned and put out another track, which was their option. But we weren't interested in that, so the conversations that we had were like no options.
Why were you not interested in that?
Because we didn't want to get... Because when you get an option, basically what happens is it means that they have the right to take any music that you write. They have the right to...
They can just have it.
Well, that's the one, to fulfill that option.
Right.
It could be that it's a remix. But what can happen is you get stuck in this everything you write for them they don't want, but they won't let you release it with anyone else. Sometimes they will, sometimes they won't. They can play these games. But the thing that we didn't want to get into was trying to fulfill this thing that we couldn't do, which was providing them with another hit, a guarantee, like, you know, you have to do it.
Like, and they can just stop you from releasing until
they can.
I
mean, normally they don't, because it's not really in their interests.
Yeah.
Yeah, they'll shelf the artist. Yeah, so basically they'll basically get you all to pay for it and do everything and then just not put it out. Yeah. And you are signed into a contract that you can't release with anyone else. Uh-huh. So you're kind of stuck until you have to... And you hear this story from artists all the time. And the other thing which is really interesting is people have this idea of what it's like to be on a major label, but actually it's not really... Well, really, you just have to do everything yourself. Mm. What the major label affords you and gives you is the budget. Is to have... £50,000-£20,000 to spend on marketing,
right?
And not, you know, but you have to have the ideas of what to do. you have to have the management and how to go about it. And ideally, you know, you can kind of contact, or at least you can help them use the context. But everything has to come from the artist. And I think that's a lot of artists don't quite realise that, that they think they get signed and then they just think, oh, the major label's going to completely do everything and take control of them, and then off they go. But actually, that doesn't that's not really how it works.
Because you see so many times someone who's not on a major will make a tune and it will do just as well, if not better, than someone that sort of signed themselves over, and it will have such a larger sort of widespread thing. I think, yeah, like you say, a lot of people don't realise maybe the sort of power that you have as an individual.
Yeah.
All that major stuff kind of scares me a little bit, to be honest with you.
Yeah, and it's full of people who just like terrible music.
Yeah,
exactly. Right? Or just haven't got a clue. Yeah. So going into this, we both knew this, both me and Denham, we kind of knew, understood. And so where it was like, if we could, we'll get the deal for just one track so we're not tied into anything. Mm-hmm. And then anything, because the other one with an option is they basically, so it's like, the option is that we'll pay you X amount of money in 6 months' time for the next track. Mm-hmm. But of course, if your first tune goes to number one, and when you come to do the option, it's already locked in. The money. Mm-hmm. So you can't really say, oh, I want more money, because you've already agreed to it.
Yeah, true.
So as if you don't have an option, then at least when they want the next one, you can go with the label that we were with before.
What are we laughing at?
What's going on?
Yeah.
What's he doing? Are you still making that remix?
Yeah.
He's locked in.
Brilliant.
He's in the sauce.
So it's you, Denham, L Major, and Manifesto are Club Bloke. How long has that been going? In fact, let's go further. Take me back to the beginning, Boris.
Oh, the beginning. When I was a little child.
What year are we talking? Set the scene. Paint a picture.
Okay. So, mid to late 90s. Uh-huh. I mean, I'm 40 years old, so I was born in 83.
Okay.
So that means that I finished my schooling like late 90s, early 2000s.
Do you know, guess what year I was born?
Go on.
Guess.
Oh, I don't know, 2000.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, fair enough.
Yes, I was in Bristol. I was 17 in the year 2000.
Wow.
I
called Dan old all the time, man.
Yeah, you got nothing.
You still look. You look a bit better than him somehow, to be fair. I don't really know what it is.
Yeah. I don't drink much.
That'll definitely do it.
That helps. And yeah, not so many drugs as well. That also helps.
That'll also do it.
But you know, hey, each
so,
to their own, right?
Mid-90s, what did you... What,
yeah,
what
so I was. So I grew up in. So I grew up in Bristol. I went to the Steiner School, or the Waldorf School.
The what, sorry?
Steiner or Waldorf. It was a kind of alternative education.
This is where it's like outdoor play and stuff, isn't it?
No, that's Montessori. Yeah, everyone always gets them confused. You will know about it if you know someone who went there.
Right.
That's it, because someone has to explain what it is and thingy. And whenever I say it, I either get people who look like, but is it this other one?
Yeah.
No, it's not. That's actually Montessori. You know, oh, wow, is that the one where you can just do what you want? No. That's Montessori. No, I had lessons in there. It was just the same. School was just the same. It was no real different. Yeah. There are a few key principles with regards to how things were taught and whatever, but ultimately... it was quite creative. Mm-hmm. They were interested in art and the creative subjects. So that was and they you know encouraged that.
Were you quite musical then because of that or?
I wasn't really. I mean, I played an instrument a bit. I got into electronic music. Mm-hmm. I started to learn the violin when I was a kid.
Ooh.
And then quite quickly realised like. No, I've got to practice. And then I got into jungle, and it's like, you can't play jungle on the violin. I'm sure someone could, but I couldn't.
Yeah. Slam it against your head or something.
Yeah, when I came to do my GCSEs, I used that as an excuse to like, oh, I've got to study to do my GCSEs, and I have time to do all the practice. I wasn't doing a music GCSE, so it was like, okay, cool, put the violin down. But then by the time I came to do my GCSEs, I discovered, you know, jungle and drum and bass. Mm. That was it. Bristol had this whole history, you know, Ronnie Size represent and full cycle, and not full, yeah, well, full cycle crew, and also Roughneck Ting was the other one. Mm. And so I kind of stumbled across this in school. You know, on the outskirts. I wasn't going to clubs. I was listening to recordings of noise.
Yeah.
It was like, it was either off the radio or it was they'd sell these, you know, rave tapes. And then they get passed, someone's older brother would have one. And then they get passed around the class and you copy them all off. So I discovered this kind of love for kind of drum and bass. By that point, it was drum and bass. It was like jungle, drum and bass. I got into it just towards the end of jungle and then drum and bass started to take over. And so I kind of realised that there was this big thing in Bristol. Bristol was like a really musical place. There was, I heard all these stories. There were record shops everywhere. Where the school was at the top of Park Street.
Right.
And at the time in the 90s, Park Street was like Stokes Croft is now.
Really?
It's like, that's where, it's where all the independent shops were.
Oh, wow.
All the cool record shops, all the cool clothes shops and everything was all on Park Street in this one. It's where Boston Tea Party, I remember when they opened.
Wow. That's and a that hell of a, that's that a hell amazing. Of a claim.
Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think there was somewhere else before. I think they're originally based in Bath or Swindon or something, but they opened
someone knows a lot about the history of Boston Tea Party.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, they're a shadow of them former selves.
Oh, God.
But the main reason being was Park Street was where all the independent shops yes. were. So that was where, and you had the skaters at the bottom in College Green. Mm-hmm. So you just had this kind of like culture where people were hanging out. There were record shops to go to that was very prevalent. And I was walking up and down there to go to school every day. So right. I eventually kind of got caught in it and through other friends of mine who were like, oh, well, you've got to check this out. We'll listen to these tapes and all this kind of stuff. And so when I went to school, when I finished school and was thinking about what I wanted to do at college,
yeah.
or either stay on it and do my A-levels at the sixth form of the school I went to, or, I mean, so I didn't do my GCSEs at the Waldorf School. The Waldorf School finished, I think, would be the end of year nine. So I had to go to a state school. Somewhere in Bristol.
Ew. Yeah.
You could go. It was. Yeah, it really was. It was amazing because I went from this place that had 300 people in the whole school to someone that had 300 people in my year.
Jesus.
I went from being the oldest to being like not the oldest. Mm-hmm. You know, we were in the top class. We were the cool kids. And then suddenly we weren't because now you're just going in at year 10.
Rob's camera has turned off. Right. For the video listeners, you're just going to have to look at a black screen for the rest of it. It's all right.
We'll give
it
a little
bit.
Mills, because he just pulled a sickie, right, didn't he?
Oh, is he? Oh.
Yeah, you heard it here first, ladies and gentlemen. Fuck Rob Mills.
Yeah,
we'll just put a photo of his face up in the meantime.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay. Ryan's still holding the fort.
Yeah, nice. Nice. Right. No, that's all good.
So you left your school and found yourself in a disgusting state school.
So I went to Filton High.
Which was
a baptism of fire, right? But
big up the Filton High massive.
Yeah, 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 absolutely. So and my brother went there before me. He's a couple of years older than me, so I'd already seen and so we knew that there were people and family friends who were there. So that was the school I went to. I had to get the train every day, so I used to go to Temple Meads and get the train to Parkway because it's 5 minutes from Parkway. So it's it was really easy.
Ooh, handy.
I used to just skip the train and keep the luggage.
Come on. What did you get? What did you spend your stolen
records on? Records.
Come on.
Right. Already buying records by that point. So.
Really?
Well, kind of starting to, because of course, having discovered this jungle and discovered this thing, and there were these record shops that were selling this stuff. It was like, you know, so one of them was Roughneck Ting. That was they opened a record shop called Breakbeat Culture that was out the back of Kushti. So Kushti Clothing was like the coolest fucking shop because it had all the cool clothes in it. And then suddenly they opened up a record shop out the back. So and what is now the back room of Kushti Clothing on Park Street was a record shop. Mm. And you go in there, and the first time I got served by MC Jakes. Because he was behind the counter. It's like, oh, wow. No way. And those are the days where, like, I mean, that one in particular, they didn't have any listening decks. So you had to go in and all the records behind the wall, behind the counter. So you had to go and ask to listen to things. And then they played them on the system. So if there was anyone else in there, you just had to, you know, you have to make sure that you've got, like, you know, the nods of approval from, like, you know, you pick out, can I listen to that one? And he puts it on. And then everyone's sitting there like, yeah. And then you're like, oh, wow. You know, I'm just shitting myself in this place full of all of these, like, what I consider these adults. They're probably only 17 or 18, but I'm like 14, 15, like, discovering this, like, wow. So I started to use my pocket money to buying. I wanted to DJ and eventually I realised I want not just to DJ, but also, you know, could I produce this music? Mm. Well, that was something that interested me. So, you know, I started reading things like Sound on Sound and just kind of starting to get in. So by the time I finished my GCSEs, I had a good idea that I wanted to go to college and study music technology because I found that there was a course that you could go on that would teach you how to use the equipment and how to write music and how to use a studio. And so then I was like, wicked, this is what I would do. And my parents, bless them, were totally supportive and just said, okay, darling, if that's what you want to
do,
off you go. So I went to the City of Bristol College and I studied and I did the BTEC in music technology.
What sort of equipment were people using then to make electronic
so
music?
It was on the cusp. So when I went, it probably would have... I was trying to think the date. So I finished school 2000 or like...
You finished school I was being born?
Yeah, yeah. I finished school. I mean, I didn't. I finished school... That's actually not true because... Yeah, I would have been 17 in 2000. So actually, I was at college. So okay. I finished school kind of 98, 99.
Oh, way before.
And then I was at first year of college, like 99, 2000.
I was just a twinkle in my father's
Absolutely
eye at that point.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, it's mad. I kind of just have to accept that.
You know, sorry, I'll stop.
I can't battle it. It's like, yeah, and... Yeah, I remember the day you were born. It was a bright day. It was very warm.
You know, my mum told me it was while I was being born, dancing in the moonlight, apparently, was playing on the radio.
Oh, well, there we go. Oh, so. Classic. Yeah, I hated that tune.
Yeah. I fucking love it.
Oh, no, it's a banger. It's a banger. Top loader, isn't it? No. Is it top loader? It's top loader. Yeah, that's their only good one.
As long as there's one contribution to the episode. He's got to get in at some point.
With that expert knowledge. That top loader knowledge. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So, and I discovered City of Bristol College, they ran this course, so I got on a course, so I probably started it. And at the time, they stopped teaching people how to use tape.
Right.
So they'd already got, I wasn't taught cutting up, splicing tape. I was taught digital, so workstations. Mm. And the first year, it was all MIDI, so it was using Cubase, but not recording any audio. And then the second year, you then moved up and they taught you Logic and DAW.
That's so handy you just caught it right after they stopped using the tape stuff, because that would have really, like...
Yeah, the year or two before, they were teaching people how to... I mean, maybe it was a few years before then, but yeah, they kind of commented, right? And they got a big dust of equipment. And then the first year, I was at the old campus, which is up on... at the top here, basically, up the top, Ashley Hill.
Yeah.
It's not in there anymore. It's half of it is there, the rest of it's houses, but it used to be the whole thing, and that was where it was. Mm. And that was the only place it was. And then they built the centre in town, where it is now.
By the harbour around there.
Yeah, by College Green. They built that campus, and we, in the music tech department, in my second year, I moved straight into there. So I kind of was quite advantaged because they pretty much spent the entire of the art budget on putting new studios and loads of new equipment. So we arrived for our second year learning all the studios, and suddenly there was like these Mackie D8Bs and all this equipment and Logic and everything. So that was quite useful. So it was quite handy. And I used to spend a lot of my time. The studios were open till 8 o'clock every night. You could just turn up, book your time in. And lots of people did, and lots of people would go do the work and then just leave. And my tutor was like, "Yeah, why are you only one of the only ones that stays?" I'm like, "That's because I haven't got any equipment at home, and this is where it is. If I want to do anything," so I was there till 8 o'clock every night.
Were you putting things out back then?
Or? No, God, no. I mean, this is the thing for me. I spent a lot of years kind of getting involved with people who then went on to put stuff out, and I would kind of live vicariously through them. So, I, you know, a lot of people I know were putting records out and, you know, in the dubstep days and this kind of stuff. But I kind of did a lot of sitting back and watching and just learning and just kind of keeping an eye and doing my thing. And then eventually...
Yeah, when did you start?
So I started...
Can you remember your first ever release?
Yeah, so it was probably... I think the first release was a joint release with my good friend October. It's called The Letter I.
Ooh.
And that came out on True Thoughts on a compilation, and I think that's 2006. So if you go it's on my Discogs. If you go on to Discogs, it's the first thing. And then the first solo release came a couple of years later from that. I think it was 2009. Maybe that's 2013, I think, was the first solo release.
Really?
Between 2006 and 2013... I was doing stuff with October, so me and him had a few releases of Borai in October. A couple of labels that came out through Idle Hands, something on Apple Pips, something for, so that's Laurie Applebloom's labels, something on Aus.
And what were you making then?
That was all kind of deep housey. It was kind of deep house, really. Kind of a little bit breakbeaty, but mostly deep house. That's what we were into. Mm-hmm. And that was like after the dubstep thing. When I got to know, it was all drum and bass. I got to know this crew in Bristol called Time Code, and they worked at the shop Breakby Culture. And so I was at college, and one of the guys was actually in the year above me at college, and he said, "Oh, look, come, I'm now, we've now opened a record shop, we're now taking over this record shop, why don't you come along?" So I turned up, and then I got to know them, and then basically got invited into their crew, and they ran a night called Time Code, and they were a crew of, like, you know, anyone, you know, in Bristol wanting to write and produce, putting on nights, just trying to do their thing.
So, nice.
And there was like a couple of older ones and then everyone else in the crew. So they're like five, six, seven, eight. There's kind of an extended family. And I got kind of like brought on and involved with all of them. So it was kind of really good because everyone that I grew up with, everyone that I went to school with originally, was all into rock music. no one that I knew was into electronic music. Everyone was into emo.
Yeah.
And by the time I went to college, that was just at the point where I was going away for myself. I wasn't really hanging out with anyone, and I didn't really have anyone because no one was doing any of the things that I was interested in. I couldn't really go to clubs because I wasn't going to go out on my own. And then I got to know these guys. And then that was it. Suddenly it was like I had a crew. Mm. And suddenly we could talk production and teach each other things, and we're playing tunes at each other and all this kind of. I always looked up to them and what they were doing. And so they were very wonderful in kind of bringing me on. And we did a few years of just like putting on parties.
Nice.
And so I started.
Just in Bristol?
Yeah, just in Bristol. I don't think we did anything elsewhere, but there. And then there was another night called Ruckus. He started doing, it was a friend, Harry, and he started doing stuff at the Thekla. So then we started putting on, being evolved and putting on nights at the
What
Thekla.
Venues were you doing before?
Mostly it was a place called Bar Latino, which isn't a place, which isn't anymore. It's kind of, I'm not sure what it is. It's a bit of a wasted venue. I think you could really have some fun with it. Although
whereabouts
now,
is it?
It's right in the centre of town. It's, well, actually at the bottom, if you go to the bottom of Corn Street, it's like a right-hand turn, and it's the one that comes out by the back of the kind of, comes out on the centre where everyone skates, and it's on the left-hand side. I cannot remember what it's called now. I have to look it up. And it's like a basement.
Not a pub.
No, it's not. It's like a door, and you have to go in it, and you go downstairs, and then it's got a courtyard as well.
And is it used now for anything? Or just like...
I think it's like a bar, but I've never... But no one does nights there. No one does anything. It might be that there's too many... They built some buildings. They built some housing around there, and that's
I'm sure
that
it's like student accommodation or something.
I remember there were being trouble doing outside things in the courtyard after a certain time because of the complaints, but inside... But it was this... It was a little club, 200-300.
Nice.
Maximum. And they used to do every Wednesday.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, that was really interesting. And they started a kind of midweek drum and bass night, so they were putting on. And my friend Ed Decoy, he was the one who kind of, he was like the patriarch. He would book one headliner, and then you would have, everyone else would be, the residents would essentially then be warming up. So it was headliner and residents. And that worked really well. It was a small night, one headliner, really good residents, and then people got to know for that. And I started to get sets through them because I would do the warm-up. And I got a lot of stuff because I wasn't playing drum and bass. I had the other records. I had like fun because I had basically anything that wasn't drum and bass.
Right.
Like for the first hour or
I feel
so,
that.
Something
I
that isn't drum
feel
and
that,
bass.
Yeah.
You know, and then second rooms and upstairs and this kind of thing. So I got a lot of sets. You know, I started my DJing career that way, but just doing the warm up sets and doing stuff because I was buying records that weren't just drum and bass. It was all sorts. I've always been interested in all sorts of music, and also I think a lot of it was like sampling. So I was buying stuff to sample all this kind of stuff. And just, you know, getting interested in different genres.
When did you bump into the club go a lot then? Was that all in
way later. So that would have been, I mean, I suppose really you get to like, well, I suppose it's not way later, but you get to about 2013. I have a solo release at a deep house. That's on Tasteful Nudes.
Tasteful what, sorry?
Tasteful Nudes.
Oh, lovely.
Yeah, great.
Excellent label name.
Yeah, absolutely. I got a T-shirt as well.
I thought you were going to say you got some tasteful nudes then.
No. Yeah, me on the front.
Lovely. I can picture it.
No. Scrub that from your mind. And so, but then I started to get a bit kind of disillusioned with this deep house thing. Everyone was getting into house and I wasn't really feeling what everyone was doing. And I wanted to kind of go back and do something else. So... and I kind of like, I was living with a friend of mine. I got kicked out of my house and my mate just said, look, move in with me. And I kind of spent a bit too long there. I stayed there for a year.
Really?
Yeah, sleeping on his sofa in the studio, right? Yeah.
That's always in every great story. Someone's come
so
up.
So we did a lot of writing music together, but then of course we ended up just spending too much time together and eventually, and it it got conflict. So I moved out and I moved into my own flat. My dad was amazing. He just said, look, do you need to borrow some money so you could just set yourself up?
Nice.
Which is what I did. And then I was like, right, I'm just going to do what I want. So I kind of... Originally, at the time, there was this like dubstep revival. And I really liked the early dubstep. Because that was the other thing about my crew. We were doing drum and bass. And then by the kind of early 2000s, 2001, 2002, we were a little bit disillusioned with where drum and bass was going. So we started getting to breakbeat. That was like Plumpty J's, kind of new school breaks and that kind of stuff. But I was a little bit like, it's all right, but it doesn't quite. And then we discovered Breakbeat Garage, and that was more interesting. And then out of Breakbeat Garage and that came Dark Garage, and out of Dark Garage came Dubstep. And my mates in Bristol were kind of really on it really early, before anyone knew what it was, before it was anything outside of London. They were like, oh yeah, there's this music. it's called dubstep. And it was like before it even has a name, it was like, there's this music, it comes out of Croydon. It's just these guys doing it in this, you know, and they do it every week on Thursday night, this place called Forward, and it's like amazing. And like, you know, and you play stuff, and you're like, well, I don't get it. It's like, no, you have to hear it on the sound system. and literally, my mate Dickon, he banged on about it for a year, and none of us quite got it. And then by the end of the year, we were like, hey man, what's this stuff that you're like telling us about? Because it kind of sounds cool. Mm. And then eventually we're like, wow, this is amazing.
Yeah, this is like changed everything. Yeah.
Changes, whoa, this is like all the stuff I liked about drum and bass, but like mixed in at a slower tempo. It was kind of garage, like, wow. And I really liked it because it was like where drum and bass was in about 96.
Right.
It was very open. The formula hadn't been restricted yet. It wasn't all half step. I liked the really breaky stuff. I liked the experimental stuff that was happening. And people were just, it was like different flavors of it. And you could kind of have a jazzy one or something sample, something kind of like Asian-y or Japanese-y one. Mm-hmm. Or you could have kind of like a wob 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 one or whatever. But it was all a bit interesting. It was more interesting and it hadn't solidified. And so we started to get into it as a crew and we started to like, and one of the people that really was at the forefront of that was Pinch, DJ Pinch.
Yeah, of course.
And he was like, he saw what was happening and he was loving it and got involved. And he was the one that started talking to the people in London. He was the one that started like, right, I'm going to put on a night. And he started running a night at the Crofters Rights where he would it was like a Wednesday night, I think it was. And
they're,
it was like
they're always on Wednesdays, all these.
Yeah,
these
well, it
nights.
Was like, but the thing you realize.
Hey, Tiny's here. Tiny and his pigtails.
Oh, my God, yes. Oh, yeah, you've got an audience now.
Good luck finding a seat for your big ass.
Oh, I think they're making room. It's all good.
There's room for you to lay along here if you want.
You can lie at the front.
Yeah. Alrighty.
Mate, nice.
Alrighty.
Nice. You can take the gimp seat. Yeah. There's always one, right? There's one seat that no one ever sits there. Yeah, some chair, wobbly chair that doesn't work. The gimp seat, that's what my crew used to call it.
I like it.
Yeah,
like
right.
It.
Yeah, yeah. Oh no, you get a gimp seat. Oh no! Someone gets up to go to the loo. Like,
Yeah, on your feet, lose your seat, etc.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So the dubstep thing, we were kind of like, it was really early on traveling, and we, you know, I was lucky enough to kind of like a bunch of us just drove to London, went to Forward, and I suddenly started experiencing this kind of the
that was absolutely mental being there at that time.
Yeah. I mean, there were a couple of experiences that were really interesting. I mean, mostly it was just completely new music. It was absolutely amazing, mind-blowing. You could still smoke, so it was pre-2007. So you go into the club and it was just like one blue light and just ganja like everywhere and everyone just standing around and things are said. It was like, yeah, no one really dances at dubstep. You're like, what? What do you mean no one really dances? And then you go and you realize what it is they're talking about, which is it's different now, but back then the beats, it wasn't this kind of high energy. It was much more, everyone was just like smoking loads of weed, drinking Guinness, looking down into your pint and just dancing in your own little thing. And so when everyone's doing that, it kind of seems like the audience isn't dancing, but everyone's just vibing. Everyone's vibing. And that's what a lot it was. And the midweek thing is kind of encourages because it's like people are always around. Mm-hmm. And so you've got the producers could come down and bring and chat. And those people, and as it started to get bigger, the weekday thing was good because on Fridays and Saturdays, people were DJing. So they couldn't all come. And you could get the guys from London to come to Bristol on a Wednesday. And so Pinch just booked all of the up-and-comers. I mean, there's a wonderful story. He booked... I don't remember where this is. I saw Skream is doing a he's doing the prop yard, and he says one of the part of the thing that's on the post I saw, which is about these, was like, yeah, Bristol's like one of the first places I partied outside of London. I was like, yeah, I know, because I was fucking there, mate. Right, you weren't called Skream, you were called Hijack's crazy brother.
Really?
And so Pinch booked Hijack to play, and it was at Timbuktu, if I remember correctly. So it was a big, and there were a few of them, and Hijack. So all the London crew used to come up, because they'd all come up, they'd all get in the cars and come up. So suddenly they, you know, you could get to meet him, and so Hijack, Pinch booked Hijack to play, and Hijack brought his little brother, who was this kid called Skream. He was fucking crazy, who turned up and just did all the cocaine and then went on, and was just like going. And everyone was like, who the fuck is this guy? He's mental. And right, then, he writes tunes, he's called Skream, he does really good stuff, he's really good.
Skream's going to have to come on the podcast now 17. To defend himself.
Yeah. Oh, mate, I mean, you know, he was lovely. He was absolutely lovely. He was lovely. I'm sure he would happily admit that, yeah, that was me.
Oh, I've got no doubt,
got no doubt. And so, and then after that, we started hearing his tunes, and it was like, whoa, wow, these are totally different from anything else. I mean, he used to get things louder than everyone else. His stuff was just like... And that was kind of fun. But yeah, so we started to do the dubstep thing, and, yeah. and then the dubstep thing kind of went places that we weren't interested in. It kind of did the whole, like, you know, went to America and the whole Skrillex you know, SpongeBob SquarePants and that all. And
sorry,
Cokie and SpongeBob. I can't even remember the name of the tune, but yeah, the tune's called SpongeBob. Okay. It's one of the first of those, like, saw-based wah-wah-wah-wah-wah-wah-wah-wah-wah-wah-wah-wah. And they were really interesting at the beginning because you would have a whole set and then you have one of those tracks.
Yeah.
And it would, like, the energy would go up to it and you'd be like, oh my God, this is amazing.
Yeah.
But soon what happened is it just soon happened to every tune was like that. Mm-hmm. And every tune is just pinned at the top, just...
You can see that in a lot of genres, I think. There's always that sort of weird, like, sort of subgenre where it's, like, much more like Aggie that starts off as, like, one and suddenly becomes, like, everyone just playing it constantly and it sort of, like, deads out a little bit.
Jump up's exactly the same.
I mean, like bass line, like all these different things.
Bass line's the same. It's this stuff that when you get into when people want impact. And it's like, and before then, it wasn't that it was impact. It was just like a cool tune or something a bit different. And everything was so, it was like, it was really interesting. And at the time, there was this real crossover between like grime and dubstep. It was like, grime was like very simple, designed for MCs to MC heavily over. And dubstep was like for people who were interested in like instrumental music. So you could have samples. You could have a lot more stuff within dubstep. And that's why I got into it. I never really got into grime.
Mm-hmm.
I was always.
Have you ever tried your hand at MCing?
Never.
No. I know you got bars.
No, I got no bars. There's no bars. There's none. For years I was an MC hater, but I've come to realise that MC has a very critical and quite, you know, instrumental job within a rave to keep things going, to keep, you know, the energy up, and to be the face of things in some respects.
Yeah.
And you know, and I think there are some classic MCs out there, some great stuff, but I do just get a bit like, you know. Grime was a bit too much. I just always felt, you know, you're hearing one really simple beat, so my producer ears are like uninterested because it's so simple. And then I'm hearing 15 people shouting down one microphone, right? And it's like vibey as hell, but like I'm just a bit like... Nice. And to me, it reminded me of like Ragga, which was the same... I had the same feeling back in the 90s. You had Chris Goldfinger. You know, you had One in the Jungle that would come on, and then at midnight, Chris Goldfinger would come on, and it'd be the same. And it'd just be like this really simple oof, 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 oof.
Yeah.
Then it'd just be like, wah, da, 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 over it. Like,
that was an amazing rendition, actually. That was really good. That was bang on. Like,
oh. And it's amazing for what it is, and I'm not knocking any of it, but it was just, it wasn't for me. And I'm just like, no, I'm interested in beats, I'm interested in music, I'm interested in sounds. And dubstep was it for me. So, but then dubstep started going to this place that I was interested in. It was all this wobble step, and it was all this kind of half step, which I didn't like. I liked the stuff that wasn't half step. But there
was full step.
Yeah, kind of full step or break step. Really, was what it was. Was the thing I liked, but it wasn't really called that.
And then when did you meet Club Glow? Sorry.
Yeah, we're just getting to that. So that would have been. So the end of dubstep. I you know, I then started. You know, we all then got into like techno, deep techno, and deep house, US stuff basically, and that's what a lot of my mates got into. A lot of that came out of like the Berlin crossover, because dubstep went to Berlin and got very techno.
Yeah, we were speaking about Berlin as well before we started. You had some wicked stories on Berlin.
My brother lives there, so hence why he's been there for, I don't know, 10 years or so now. So
nice.
I've kind of like I used to go there quite regularly. Mm-hmm. He's got kids now, so it's a bit more difficult. But yeah, I've spent a good time in Berlin.
Nice.
So yeah, I've gone to the and again, my mate, he started to get booked in Berlin, so I've been to Berlin.
Have you ever played out there?
I have, yeah, only a couple of times. Berlin's really interesting because it's like at the time, I never played the same stuff, but I did. I got booked and I played in a place called Renata's, which was really good. Yeah,
nice.
Yeah, I played for like 5 or 6 hours.
Wow.
And I played vinyl as well, so it was just a fucking.
My God.
Record.
What do you play for 5 or 6 hours?
You just play every record you fucking own, basically.
Yeah. Oh my goodness.
Yeah,
me.
I forgot. I was like, oh God. And at first I was really worried, like, I don't have, you know, Berlin's got this Berlin sound, right? I don't have any of the records. My mate does, he's called a record. I haven't. I'm like, But I just thought, well, I'll just go and do what I do. So I went and did what I did. And then I found out later, actually, it was like my brother was there. And he went, and I'd given him some of my drinks tokens.
Classic.
So he went to the bar, because I wasn't going to drink him. So he went to the bar to get a drink. And the bar was like, got a drink token. I was like, oh, who are you with? Like, oh, yeah, how'd you get these?
Right.
So I said, I'm with the guy that's playing now, like, Borai. And my brother said, he said the bar staff was like, oh, yeah, he's really good. He's really different.
Nice.
And I was like, if we can get the bar staff, then you're in. So in that respect, that was quite fun. But yeah, I haven't had loads of gigs there. I've played twice. One was in Renata. That was the best one in Renata. And then I played in a place called Ipsa. but that was really quiet. So we
may. Did you pay for $11,000 there?
No, that was only a couple of hours.
Only a couple of hours. Just a short set.
It got shortened as well. So it was. I was like, there was no one there. So it was like, it's all good. We'll close early. I don't mind. I still got paid. So it's fine.
Perfect.
And so, you know, we gone through the techno thing, and then me live with my mate, and then I move out. I go on my own. I'm then like, oh, there's this dubstep revival. So my brain is like, hey, breakstep. Like that early stuff, the stuff I really liked, maybe that's what they're going to be really into. Like, actually, what I discovered was that no, the dubstep revival was everyone wants to sound like Komodo. It's like, okay, people weren't going back early enough. Mm-hmm. They were going back to the dubstep that I'd already got bored of, not the stuff that, like, the really early breaksteppy, Toasty Boy, the fun things, Search and Destroy, all this stuff that no one's got a clue who they are, but they made some great records. So I originally was like, oh, I'm going to write some 140 kind of like with break beats and do some kind of dubstep and show them what it's done. And then realized that no one was going to listen to it because the dubstep kids weren't going to.
Do you ever try to make beats like that now?
Kind of. I mean, it's actually what ended up turning into the Club Glow stuff because it was the Anybody from London EP. I started writing tracks and then eventually I had this idea to have like four tunes, one at 130, one at one. You know, one at 120 something, one at 130, one at 140, and one at 150. Mm-hmm. And I started to think about, like, you know, what could you do with breakbeats and 4/4? And I was thinking about jungle techno, but that was quite fast. So I was like, could you do it a bit slower? Mm-hmm. And so I wrote, so the idea was like, I had a 120 something breakbeat tune. There was a 130 kind of breakbeaty tune. That was Anybody from London. Mm-hmm. There's a 140 track, which was Never As Good. Mm-hmm. Again, kind of breakbeaty thing, but with a 4/4, so a bit like jungle techno.
Right.
And then I did a straight 150 jungle techno track. And the idea is that you could go up to 150 by playing all these tunes one after another. Mm. Not that I've ever done that or anything, but that was just my idea.
Yeah.
And then when I kind of wrote that and it was like, okay, cool. And then I was like, who's going to put it out? Mm. Who? Are there any drum and bass labels? No. Like any older labels that might be interested in sound? Like no. And then I discovered that there was a burgeoning breakbeat scene. Mm-hmm. That loads of 18 and 19 year olds were suddenly getting into all the old.
And what year was this, sorry?
So this was probably 2013, okay. Something like that. 2013, 2014. I think, 2014 would probably be it. Mm. It was that year after like 2013 into 2014
where
it then started to, like, you know, it started to galvanize for me. And then I suddenly discovered that there was this breakbeat scene and there were people involved in it and there were kids doing stuff and they liked a lot of the old hardcore. That was a lot. It was like, okay, cool. So the jungle techno and the hardcore stuff.
Yeah.
There's kind of seeming this as a bit of a revival. They might be interested in it because they like the breakbeat stuff. So, okay. Mm-hmm. So I then kind of sent out the tunes to a couple of people and I sent Anybody from London to Hodge. Mm-hmm. And he played it as the last tune on his Boiler Room.
Nice.
They did a Boiler Room in Bristol and he played it as the last tune and everyone was like, what is this track? What is this? And that was really good for me.
Yeah, no doubt.
And then eventually I got the EP signed to Hotline Records, which at the time was a kind of very cool label coming out of Bristol. They were doing very cool things. They'd been written about in The Wire and all sorts of kind of stuff. So it was my mate Dan that ran it. So I kind of sent in the tunes more as like, oh, do you know anyone that might be interested in putting these out or whatever? And he came back and was like, can I have them? Can we put them out and do a double pack with all four?
Yes,
I was
please.
Like, yeah, of course, like wicked. And so that gave me a really good start and showed me that there was this breakbeat scene that was starting to happen and there were people doing stuff. And that was where I met Denham Audio. And so I released Anybody from London. A few people noticed what was going on. I mean, I'm not to blow my own trumpet, but I've had a few conversations with people who were like, yeah, I kind of heard that and was like, hey, I might give it a go. Like, that sounds cool. So I think it kickstarted a few people to start looking at that breakbeaty stuff.
For sure.
And then Denham Audio hit me up and just said, look, I love your Anybody from London tune. I know about them because they'd done a breakbeat remix of Foot Grab by Alison Groove.
Mm-hmm.
And they'd sent it to Alison Groove and Alison Groove liked it so much that he put it out.
Mm-hmm.
So I was aware of Denham Audio. And so they hit me up and just said, hey, look, you know, we love your stuff. Do you want to write a tune together? And at the time there were three of them.
Mm-hmm.
But I only ever dealt with one.
Oh really?
Which was Perry. Yeah, and what was really funny is I watched him talk to everyone in Bristol. I literally watched him email everyone because everyone I was like, oh, you talked to them. Oh, you talked to Denham Audio. And I was like, hey, these guys called Denham Audio just emailed me. Have you come across them? Oh yeah. And it's so funny. Literally, I think Perry said he literally just emailed everyone.
I forget that one of the people. There was more than one.
Yeah, there were. I mean, it came later. Came to find out that really, ultimately, the real kind of like.
Yeah.
you know, the move, the force behind it was Perry, was Denham, who we know now.
Yeah.
At the time, there were two others. One was more of a DJ. The other one, John, is Groovy D.
Yeah, that was it. Yeah, I remember there being two at some point, then there not being two. And I forgot where the other guy went, but that was it.
Groovy D and Emilio was the other one. And Emilio was more the DJ. Mm-hmm. Groovy D was more into production, and Perry was like the businessman.
Yeah. Okay.
So a lot of the early productions were like John and Perry and Emilio kind of doing it, and they all started. It's the classic at university. They started at uni, and you know they were kind of inspired by Hessel Audio, and they started doing their own thing. But it was really Perry that just kind of carried on doing it, and the others just kind of were like, okay. So as everything started to pick up, it kind of seemed a good idea that maybe it was a good idea if, like, you know, I only deal with one person, you only deal with one person, why are there now three people every time we have a fucking gig? Do they need to be here?
See ya, get rid of them.
And essentially what happened was I think the conversations were had, and actually it worked out really well, because it meant that you know, John Groovy D was able to start his Groovy D,
and he's killing it with that, right?
And he's absolutely killing it right now, and brilliant, because he's an amazing producer, so I'm like wicked. And Emilio, I think, very much was kind of like, he seemed to be just kind of in it, because why not? You know, he's a really good, he was a flashy DJ.
I know that feeling.
it's just easier, right? And so, but eventually that all kind of figured out. Yeah. And so, yeah, me and Denham, we started chatting, we started writing tunes together. We realized that these were quite cool. We liked what we were doing, but record labels weren't really putting them out. So maybe we should, he had the idea originally, why don't we do a cassette tape? Like, we've got enough tracks to kind of do it. And that was Club Glow number one. And then from that, we got Manifesto involved, because he did the artwork for the first one.
Right.
And then we were looking at, like, well, we want to do a set. It did really well. We sold out them all. So, like, let's do another one and let's maybe increase it. So let's have a, let's see if we can bring someone on. And we kind of came across L Major. He came kind of highly recommended. We were starting to hear his tunes from West Norwood Cassette Library and stuff. And, yeah, I mean, when I first heard L Major stuff, I was like, damn. I thought I right and like yeah, damn, he's doing it better than I'm doing. Like, he's doing like the same idea that I have, but he's doing it better. Like, oh no. And then I was like, I better
get him into my team.
Yeah,
quick.
That was it, right? Yeah, if you can't beat him, join him, right? So we invited him, and we kind of me and Perry were like, yeah. And I was listening to stuff, and Perry was like, yeah, but listen, this guy L Major, would you reckon? I was like, Christ, that's brilliant. Let's get him on board if we can. And Louis, bless him. I had a release on a label called Them that came out of a record shop in London called Container Records. That's sadly not there anymore, but they had an in-store release for it. And the guy that booked it, he booked L Major. Said, "Oh look, I know this guy Louis L Major. I think you two would, think it'd be really good to come and play." And I was like, "Wicked," because then I get a chance to meet him. And we turned up, and I turned up and met him. And yeah, we just got on like a house on fire. We realized how similar we were, and our music outlooks, and how we want to do things. And so after that, it was like, yeah, let's invite him to the crew. So we kind of cordially asked him, we're like, "So Louis, do you want to be part of our gang?"
Please, can you join
our gang? And he was gracious and was like, "Yeah, absolutely." And he came on board and it's been brilliant. And so yeah, that's where the Club Glow thing. So I felt it's been really nice having four of us, because we can kind of, everything's a bit easier. We can kind of back things off each other. I mean, honestly, you know, Perry's still putting a lot of work in, and still at the forefront of a lot of stuff with regards to Club Glow as well. So he's very much a leading light, and we all kind of, but we do make sure that we chat about stuff and we discuss things.
Of course.
And you know, we all have to do things with everyone's agreement. And that we're happy to. I mean, there is a little thing. Well, I'd like it if we were all living in the same place. That would be nice. I think we'd probably
not
see
all
each
Bristol.
Other. No, everywhere, all around the country.
Oh,
so,
really?
So yeah. So I'm in Bristol. Manifesto's down in Tunbridge Wells or South Coast.
Very nice.
He's originally from Brighton. So he's just. I think he's just. It's somewhere that's not London. That's like, you know, in between. So. And then Louis, he's from London, so he lives in London. And then Perry, Denham Audio, he's from Sheffield. So from all over. So it can make it difficult, us all getting into the same place to do stuff at once. But, you know, we kind of do.
Speaking of making it difficult to get in the same place at once, Offbeat.
Yes.
I thought we should touch on that, definitely.
Yes, definitely.
So, I mean, obviously it's a new label you've started recently with you and your partner, Yana.
Yeah, I met Yana probably a couple of years ago now. I don't know if it's been quite two, but she'll scold me for not knowing, but it's fine. but yeah, we met and kind of got on like a house on fire, realised we had a lot of similarities, liked a lot of stuff. And then we kind of discovered Hard House kind of at the same time, just something new.
And well, how did you just?
She's an expert discogger.
Oh, I've heard about this. Like, she digs.
Oh, she is a digger, like a hardcore digger. And she's really interested in UK music. So she's based in Germany. She's based in Cologne. Mm. She's, you know, she's DJing with a crew out there and doing her own thing. But it's difficult to get hold of UK music in Germany. Mm. You have to order it all off Discogs. And of course, Brexit's just messed everything up because deliveries are now crazy expensive. Mm-hmm. And sellers won't even sell. So she had this idea of like, well, why don't I just fly there and go shopping? and bring it back with me. And she messaged me on Instagram just to say, hey, I'm coming to Bristol to go record shopping. Do you recommend any record shops? So, of course, I was like, yeah, try Prime Cuts, try Collect Cave, all the, you know, la, la, la. And then it was, of course, like, well, you know, if you're in town and go shopping or whatever, just, you know, let me know. That's all good. Mm. And then she came. And then there was this. I mean, I'm sure she won't mind if I say, but
here you go.
She arrived. So the Friday night. So I knew she was coming for the weekend. We've been chatting a little bit, but she's like, "Oh, you're coming to the weekend? Well, I'll book it. I'll see you on a Saturday or something. If you're free,
if you're busy. Don't want to be
creepy. Like, you know, like, come on, she don't know who I am. Like, we haven't actually met yet. And then Friday, I'm at home. And I just get a message from her just going, I'm really sorry, but is there any chance if I send you some PayPal money that you could give me some cash? And I was like, why? And so it turns out that she was at the airport and in between getting off the plane and going through customs, she'd left her passport on the plane. And her money and her wallet with absolutely everything on it. And she couldn't go back because the plane had gone off to the next one. So they let her in because, of course, she'd managed to get on the plane. Yeah. So, of course, it was like, okay, fine, you've lost it, but that's fine, you can come in. Mm. But she didn't have any money. She didn't have anything. All she had was her phone and PayPal, which she could use on her phone. And she told me, she said she was chatting to her friend, kind of explaining the situation. Her friend was like, well, why don't you just call the guy? She's like, I can't call the guy. He's nowhere. Like, you know, but she did, and so she messaged me, and I was like, oh my god, you're stuck without any money, without a passport, without a thing. Like, fuck. Okay. Okay. Cool. Let's figure it out. So we got it figured and eventually and sorted, and then she came into Bristol and we ended up getting on like House on Fire and hung out.
Thank God she lost her passport.
Yeah, right. It was like, wow, no way.
So the label itself is focused around like hard house, that older sort of sound, like offbeat basses.
So it kind of came out of her, a lot of it came out of her love for kind of UK stuff. We were looking at garage, but also looking at this kind of like, she really likes the kind of like bouncy. Mm-hmm. track. So we were trying to find out where you would get this stuff with this kind of what quote unquote offbeat bass line. It's bottom. Yeah. But it wasn't donk, wasn't something else. Maybe it was a bit softer. And of course it's hard house. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh yes, God. Duh. You know, like we were there going, where do you find all this stuff? Like, where is it? Like Eurobeat? Like, yeah, there's probably some Eurobeat and some, you know, there's some techno crossover, and there's a lot of stuff that has that bottom bass line in it. And it's all in different genres as well over the years. And all sorts of different stuff. But a lot of it was suddenly there was this hard house, and she found a couple of tunes and were just like, ooh, where did you find that? What? Oh, this is, oh my God, this is hard house, of course.
Yeah.
And for me, hard house has been a dirty word for years. You know, the whole time the hard house was big in the 2000s, I was into drum and bass. Uh-huh. And hard house was like,
really? Oh, that's awful. So interesting.
Yeah, that's what's really funny. I kind of did that with garage, though. Mm-hmm. I spent the whole time I was in drum and bass going, garage, and then spent 10 years going, garage is amazing. So I've kind of learned to not. That was then, this is now.
Yeah.
I know different things, and I have different sensibility. So we just started to kind of like enjoy these records and this sound, and it kind of led to, well, should we write some of it?
Because you've been writing quite a lot of bits, and they're all sounding very, very nice.
Oh, well, thank you very much. We're really pleased with them. And part of it is just getting her involved and teaching her music production. Mm-hmm. And we started, you know, we wrote a couple of things that kind of speed garage bits. And then very quickly, I think the third tune we wrote, we just scrapped it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
just was like, hey, what's this? Boom,
yeah, boom, boom. That's much better. That's much more.
Hey,
much
wow, 150 BPM. Woo!
Yes.
and like, that's where the magic happens, right?
Yes, it really exactly
is. It is. 150 BPM is where the magic happens.
That's a resounding yes.
Yeah, right? Yeah. Like, woo! Bring it on. And so we were like, okay, cool. Well, let's write some stuff. And
so
out of that came offbeat. And so it was like a name to describe, which, you know, could it be the name of the project or could it be the label?
Yeah,
and so
it's a label, yeah.
Essentially, although we've only got one tune out at the moment. Mm-hmm. It's a label, it's a club night. We decided not to be the artist. We decided we weren't going to be offbeat.
Yeah.
But we would be Borai and Don't Forget to Go Home.
For sure.
I mean, why? Because two names are better than one, right?
Yeah.
Why not? and so offbeat is essentially the label, the project. Mm-hmm. It could be a label. It could be a club night.
I'm so excited to see what you guys have got coming
out. Yeah, we've got a bunch of stuff. We need to kind of figure it out. And the latest thing, which has been really good, was we did a remix of Make Me. And we did it for ourselves. And she suggested it. She's just like, hey, we should do a fluffy, bumpy version of Make Me because there isn't one. Mm-hmm. I was like, yeah, why not?
Mm-hmm. I'm a little bit fuming that one's actually been released now, to be honest.
They were really quick on it. Yeah. And also, I don't know if you've noticed, but you're quite lucky. You can't download it anywhere.
Really?
No.
Really?
No.
So I can't download it.
So I need to go back to the label and be like, hey guys, what the fuck are you playing at? Why can't, it's not on, it's only on streaming.
What label is it?
It's on Room 2. It's on
Room 2, listen up, yeah.
Yeah, like what's going on? Like, come on. I mean, I think it'll be fine. I just need to send a to be like
yeah, yeah.
And also what's mad is everything's on in WhatsApp groups now. That was the thing that totally
hilarious.
Amazed me. And you're sat there doing business at like 8 o'clock at night because that's just how it is now. Everyone's just firing things into these group chats. There's no emails. There's no like, it's like,
you can't
wow.
switch off from it then though, can you? It's just always there.
That's why. Well, you just ignore it. Yeah, they don't. And it's quite why it's quite hard work, I think, working in those kind of industries because it's like, it doesn't stop. And everyone knows that everyone's available all the time. So it's a bit kind of annoying.
Not for me. I think music's a fad, really. I think it's just going to die out pretty soon. where are we at? Where are we at for time, right?
Oh, yeah, God. Yeah, I've probably been gassing.
1 hour and 6 minutes. Okay. 1 hour and 6.
All right. So we're going to take this to extra time.
Oh, yeah, we're already in extra time. For your closing, I realised you completely forgot to do the opening track, but it's fine. It doesn't make a single difference.
No.
Closing track.
No. Oh, let's just think, what's the closing
do
track?
Do you have an idea? Do you want to just do yours and Yara's Make Me edit?
Yeah, we can play the Make Me edit. I think that'd be nice to finish on, because that's the most current thing that we're kind of pushing at the moment.
Yeah, yeah, 100%.
Yeah, and without having anything, I haven't got any unreleased anything, and it is readily available, so...
Is it on all streaming services?
Yeah.
Is it on Dizay?
I think it is.
Oh
yeah.
My goodness!
I know, right?
That's when you know it's real.
Yeah, yeah.
Anything else you want to add before we land this goddamn plane?
Just to say, big ups to yourselves. Big up to Bell.
Big ups for the support, you, my good man.
And I love it. And I think you touched upon it slightly earlier, which is like, you know, getting into the kind of major label thing. For me, it was about like, okay, do that, but also don't stop doing stuff like this.
Yeah.
Because if I can keep doing things like this, it's what helps. Then I can bring my experience of working at major labels to what you guys are doing, you know, be it questions or just telling you about the experiences, rather than doing that and then just disappearing, never to be heard
100%.
Again,
right? I think, yeah, definitely, yeah. Like, the love is both ways, like the appreciation of myself and everyone has for you, like,
yeah, wicked.
Keeping it underground, mate.
Yeah, and like I say, I've lived in Bristol all my life and I've kind of come out of Bristol music. So for me, it's all about like, let's keep that.
100%.
Now, how can I give back in some respects or keep that going?
That's what makes Bristol special, man.
Yeah,
it's
definitely.
Nowhere else, nowhere else.
Yeah, wicked.
Run the rhythm, producer.
Run the rhythm.
Man.
Gotta find it now.
Yeah, edit. Oh wait, it's been taken down. You've had a cease and desist.
Yeah, right. Hey, there it is.
Perfect.
There it is. Yay. Woo!
Oh, thank you. Too easy, man. That was sick. That was really good. Man.